Καλησπέρα. Good afternoon or good morning, depending from which part of the world you're watching us. My name is Marianela Cloca, and today, under the topic Women Who Build the Future Towards a Nonviolent Culture, a series of video interviews under this title, I have the pleasure, on behalf of Presenza, to introduce to you Alexia Tsouni from Greece. Alexia is an activist whom I met many years ago under the occasion of our common activist efforts to create awareness about disarmament in the center of Athens in Greece. One of the photographs of this event is now very popular, as it shows in a very simple way that states should change their funding priorities, and instead of arms, they should fund public health and public education. Later on, we have collaborated in different fields. In addition, Alexia works as a volunteer in the online feminist website, The Purple, which is media partner of our agency. But maybe it's better to give the floor to you, Alexia, so you can share with us some things about yourself.
Thank you, my dear. Indeed, it's so nice to remember all the interesting things we have been doing so many years. So many, you see, intersections among the different movements. It's true, indeed. So I had started actually as an activist when I was in Athens, when I came to Athens to study as a student, because before I was in a small town where I grew up, and my first occasion to actually be involved in like this, in movements for human rights, for non-violence, peace, feminism, actually it was after 18 years old. So I had the opportunity in Athens to first of all to be active in Amnesty International, and then to get to know what's happening all around the world with this kind of movements, and to take action. And then also here in a local level, to start to be active in feminist organizations and also in the anti-war movement and anti-militarism. And indeed, I see how much, for example, they were also asking me why you are involved, for example, for conscientious objectors against the army or the military, you know, the compulsory military service that we still have in Greece. But indeed, I consider all these things interconnected, because violence is has a lot of forms. There is the institutional violence from the state, from the police, from the army. There is the interpersonal violence, domestic violence. And this is a, you know, it's a circle, we say. And
a vicious one.
Vicious circle, yes, indeed. So if we want to indeed make a non-violent future, I think we need to work on all these fields, from the personal one to the social one, to the political one. We must focus a lot, first of all, on the democracy, to have the institutions working well, functional democracy with checks and balances, accountability, to control the power, what's going on, what they do on behalf of our names, how do they govern, how do they move all the decisions around our lives, because actually it's for us. And indeed, this is one of these sectors, for example, is the expenses. We cannot have so much military expenses. And this is the tragic coincidence now that with the COVID we have seen, actually, we were always demanding social expenses instead of military expenses. And you see now how tragically life has indeed, confirmed that we need to focus more on people rather than bringing together people, serving people, serving really human needs rather than military equipment and focusing for, you know, conflicts and wars and these kind of things.
Mm-hmm. Another issue of our recent weeks is also the defunding of the police, which is another another way of asking for more funds to the public sector, to health and education, than asking for arms and also for police due to the recent events.
Exactly. Now this period, they also want to put police in the universities. Actually, they passed already this law, and which is this is not the problem of Greece, where police is everywhere. It's not this our problem. But you see, on the other hand, when a woman goes to police, we have seen this. We have a lot of cases of this in our feminist organization, the Purple. When a woman goes to police to report domestic violence, for example, we don't have always, okay, no, I don't want to be absolute, because sometimes, depending where you in the police station or the person, the policewoman or the policeman himself, but we have also very, very tragic cases that they are not served, and they told them, go back to your husband, even if there is serious abuse, even there if there are children, everything. So what we want is really to have a focus on the human being and on the sectors and on the society and on the all these democratic values and the mentality to coexist together in peace and harmony, to co-create things for a better future. But all this starts from very, very beginning, from the early ages. For example, we need an education, even from our homes, to stop the stereotypes, you know, to stop the roles that they are defined, and they keep us unequal, keep the discriminations continuing in every field, not only for the feminist, for example, also for the racial, for whatever. We need to stop us also to become better people, like every human being, to become a better person, so that we can all indeed go towards a nonviolent world.
Alexia, can I ask you something more in person? What led you to activism? What led you to commit yourself to such issues? And also to commit yourself for such a long period of time, because I know you're an activist for many years. So what is this thing that makes you commit yourself?
Look, I think that I am privileged, more or less. First of all, being white, being in a country that, okay, we have a democracy. It's not working as we should, as we would like always, but okay, I feel I am an average, you know, in the world level. I think I'm privileged. So I don't want to say that, okay, in my small world, you know, in my bubble, I'm just fine and I don't care what's happening in a country far that maybe I didn't even know the name or where it was, or even close to us, to the next refugee camp inside Greece, in a small island of Greece on the borders. So more and more, when I was focusing and I was learning more about the actual situation, I was, on the one side, I was very furious and very angry of the things that I discovered happening, so much injustice, you know. And really, I had a rage also, especially when I was younger, but then I see how I should tackle with this, what I should do, and what is the solution. Because I have, okay, I have read some history, I have watched, I have read some books, what's happening in other countries and here. So what I finally, where I conclude finally, is that I need to really to be active and to participate in the society, you know, as an active citizen, as an activist, and to network. It's very important. And now we have the tools to network, we have direct communication with like a movement from other countries. We have news agencies that they are independent, like Presenza, for example. We have the tools now. We are more lucky than other times. It's more easy now. But we need to have actual communication, because we have the capacity, the technological capacity, but we need to have a real understanding and not fanatism, you know, not the phenomena like echo chambers or trolls, you know, in the social media, because it can really be good and helpful tool, all these things, but it can really destroy you, and it can really destroy a whole society, a whole democracy. We need to really be careful. But this was my personal motivation. I told you, I was a bit privileged. I felt, I don't know, psychiatrically, maybe I felt something, some guilty or some that I need to do more for other people as well. But really, I believe that, you know, we do say this, injustice somewhere is injustice everywhere. I do believe this is very, very, very true. In all, you know, directly, indirectly, it's really true. You cannot have a genocide happening somewhere, or you cannot have even in your country someone suffering, being arbitrarily arrested, and what? And you say, okay, me, I'm free now. I'm in my house, I'm free. No, no, it's not like this. It doesn't work like this.
We are all interconnected, and happiness is something more, is something that we have to gain collectively, maybe. Exactly. I suppose that as human beings, we didn't do everything wrong till now. Surely, we need to do it better. So I would like to ask you, what tangible and intangible elements mm-hmm. can we save from the past and the present mm-hmm. in order to build actively mm-hmm. The nonviolent future that we desire? So tangible and intangible from the past and present. And also, in addition, what new materials do you think that we should create mm-hmm. in order to enforce this direction, the nonviolent direction for the humanity?
Mm-hmm. From the past, we have a lot of lessons to learn from the past, indeed, because we have seen how the world has evolved and what happened, good and bad. So we have seen wars, very destructive ones, and world wars, and we have seen also military dictatorships. We have seen a lot of even these segregations and racism and this slavery. We have seen all these things. So first, I think from the past, we should first of all learn, read, study, and also analyze. You know, it's not just the information, it's also to analyze what were the circumstances under which all these things, why Hitler was successful, for example, but also the good things, what Gandhi, for example, achieved, Martin Luther King, what nonviolence, how it inspired people, and it really made a revolution and the successful revolutions. So first, I think we should study, we should analyze the past and take the lessons, both good and bad, not to repeat, of course, the same mistakes. But then we need to have also education from the first basic level, from the school, to have lessons like, you know, serious syllabus, like civics, the political science, I don't know, international relationship, how to make conflict resolution, and how to make diplomacy, how to make internationalism more connections between people, because, you know, most of the times I think it's the fear that prevails, and sometimes conflicts are and also fanatism is this is the ground where it's based on the fear of the different thing, maybe or of the equality missing in all the levels. So even from patriarchy, for example, patriarchy is based on suppressing women because, I don't know, they fear if we are equal, or white supremacy, they suppress the black people. And I think we should stop having fear, get to know each other really, and then see the added value of a really a diverse society, diverse community. But this indeed, not everyone would like this. So we have some institutions that, for example, like the United Nations, you know, after the Second World War, we have some institutions that they were formed so that we don't go back there. We have some treaties. We had this successful, this good news for the nuclear this previous year. So we have some instruments that are good, but of course also they are not panacea, we say. They're not the...
Good for everything, yes.
Good for everything, and also it's controlled, of course, from big powers. But this is the way that we must develop, you know, a mentality of cooperation, a mentality of culture, a culture of mutual understanding. It's, I think, it's on both levels, personal and on the common, you know, the
social.
Outside, level that. We need to start being serious, to start thinking, analyzing more, not stay on the surface, to think more and to really
compassion. Compassion maybe is a virtue that you think that could help us overcome fear.
Exactly. This is a good notion, a good concept.
A good quality.
Yeah.
Which you also have so much of it.
you speak now for me. Okay, it's okay.
Yes, because I know you so many years, so I think I am allowed to say that.
But I cannot say speaking.
I would like to thank you very much, Alexia, for this short interview, being part of our
women. It's a great initiative that you have taken, and I am so excited to read the... To listen, also to watch anyway the other interviews that are already taken.
Okay, I send my regards to all the women in the purple.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And we will find ourselves again in the street very soon, I hope.
We are also in the street even now.
We are, we are already, we never left the streets.
We continue.
The streets and the internet and the screens. Thank you very much.
I thank you. Thank you so much.